So what was his name?
John Gaskin.
John Gaskin. I don't know if you ever heard of him. He was
Gaskin
in radio or something.
Familiar.
He was in radio back in Lincoln, I think it was.
He ended up there. Yeah, he's a big Cornhusker guy.
Yeah.
Okay, we're rolling.
Okay, all right, here we go. This is segment two. 13 minutes begins in 3, 2, 1. And hello, everyone. Welcome to The Real Estate Show on KCMX News Media 880. Pete Belcaster and Joe Brett, the real estate guys, with you today. And thanks for joining us here on KCMX as we continue towards the end of 2018. My goodness, I can't believe we're 11 months into this year. It seems like, you know, it was only yesterday kind of thing. But maybe the older we get, the more the faster it goes, it seems anyway. But here we are at the end, right?
Towards the end of the game, especially if you're a little behind the clock, it's ticking faster, it
yeah,
seems
it sure
like.
Does.
So that's where it is.
Anyway, today on The Real Estate Show, we are just excited because Alice Lima is here with us today. Alice is a broker at John L. Scott, has been with us many times on the show. We do a lot of real estate talking together, traveling together, and that kind of thing. And it's good to have you here. How are you doing?
Oh, doing great. Happy to be back.
Yeah, here we are, December. I mean, December. The winter selling season in a normalizing market, right?
Yeah, and it's pretty strong. It's encouraging. I mean, the prices are still falling and soft, and different neighborhoods are struggling, but we still have a lot of buyers out there, a lot of momentum to avoid the next interest rate increase.
Yeah. So you're seeing a lot of activity, aren't you?
Yeah, and the good weather helps.
Yeah, I guess now we're
good weather
would
be rain.
But that only just started.
Yeah. So you're seeing some good positive signs, because when you were here last time, remember we talked about how the market was changing.
Yeah, and the prices are soft, and they are still going down, but there's still a lot of buyers.
There's still the buyers out there. I have heard, have you guys heard this, that I've heard agents say they've had more contact with people from California out of these fires, especially in the Paradise area, that are kind of circling themselves up here because there's no place to go.
Yeah, and they can still keep an eye on their projects. Paradise is not such a long drive, right. So Medford's a natural choice.
All right, well, that's interesting to hear as well. Sitting next to Alice is Travis Hand, who owns the owner of Rogue Inspection Services. And Travis got to the Rogue Valley via Nebraska, so a long way from there to get here. But you started your own business, and I know you work a lot with Alice. So first of all, welcome to our show. It's nice to have you here. Yeah,
thank you.
How did you end up here, out of Nebraska to Medford?
We just love the area. Everything's so beautiful. It's a place we've wanted to live forever, so we finally made it happen in May.
You did.
My wife and my kids and I moved out here, and we've been happy ever since.
And the rest is kind of history.
It's history.
So he's an inspector, a home inspector, right?
Right.
Yes, and he was from Colorado and had a good business out there. So when he came out here and got his license and set up his shop, of course.
You know. And you're still in doing that now. And you do a lot of different. Well, first of all, how busy are you, also, Travis? I mean, we always need to know how busy we are, because the real estate market is so huge, and encompasses so much. From inspections on down. So tell us about what you're seeing in the market here in December.
Yeah, everything's it's staying pretty steady as far as the work that I'm getting. Been averaging about 40 inspections a month, so that's going to increase a little bit here, hopefully. I just hired another inspector, so that would like
well,
to
that's a good sign.
Keep that going. We did slow down a little bit last week with the holiday, probably end up about 5 inspections short of 40 this month with the holiday season, but still staying pretty steady.
That's good to hear. I mean,
that's
in
20
you know,
business days. Well, you probably mix in some Saturdays too to keep up with it all.
Well, of course, I mean, I think that's really an encouraging sign. Also, talking about activity. I just want to share this with you because we do it every week, and I just want to get Alice's comment, you know, on a real estate review. And you can go on to our website and look at these numbers themselves. And last week was also, remember, was a holiday, Thanksgiving. Still, there were 48 new listings in Jackson County, only 12 in Josephine County. They kind of went down. Pending sales last week were 66. I mean, the week before it was 77, so that's pretty good. Pending sales in Josephine County were 20, down from 29. Closed transactions, which is what, you know, tell the real story, don't they? The real story of real estate is a closed transaction. Jackson County had 43 last week compared to 71 the week before, expected. And Josephine County had 14. So that's down, you know, but it's probably the lowest week that we've had in I have to go back last winter maybe even to hit that, or the last holiday, because we track it every week, and it's a lot going on.
And that's still quite a few listings.
Yeah,
and I think
yeah.
that's part of a normalizing, softening market. You're going to have more supply, and that's going to have an effect on prices.
Mm-hmm. You're in winter months, and you look at the statistics, you know, that we see each week in our office meetings, you see it November and December are the two lowest months of the year in listings and sales traditionally, right? Then it starts to go back up as you get to January, you know, February, March, April. So, but this is really a good time, Alice, for people to consider selling. Why?
Well, I think if you're considering selling anytime in the next 36 months, you would be better off doing it now because there's just going to be more and more competition as the market continues to change. Plus, the interest rates are still right around 5%. For those who are older, you know, we remember even more than 5%. We remember 11, 16.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the Feds really want to normalize that whole monetary situation. So you're going to have more buyers. They're going to be able to afford a higher price point. We have people that would have written an offer $20,000, $30,000 higher this month if they could have, and they just can't. Mm-hmm. And we have another one looming in December, and how many coming next year?
Yeah. Well, I think this week it was that range for a 30-year fixed was about 5 to 5.5%. Mm-hmm. And they've held steady. When the stock market kind of did its thing, it kind of stopped the increases.
Right,
you know,
right.
Hopefully they won't go up. I don't know. I don't want them to go up because so many people then can't afford at the other end
of the spectrum,
and that's the problem.
It's pushing him down into the next price point lower.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And every point is about 10%. So if you have a $300,000 house, then that buyer with tears and gnashing of teeth is going down to have to buy something more at the 270 range.
Yeah.
Because they've already been working so hard at 300 to find the right place and to get in and get the deal done, and then that just...
And down payments and all that and closing costs. Yeah.
Well, what's so interesting to me in the market is that there are really two markets. There's a market $500,000 and below, and there's a market $500,000 and above. And the two are kind of in conflict kind of more or less with each other because they're very real, right? I mean, when I say that, it's $500,000 and below is the reason for what? I mean, that's what people are buying. They have this month supply of inventory is still in a seller's market.
Mm-hmm.
When you go above 500,000, you've got 20 months supply in some categories, price categories.
Well, and I think it also has to do with our employment situation and wages locally.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And if people come from out of town and they have a higher price point because they just sold a house from a big city, then, you know, they look at our inventory and they think it's just the best deal since sliced bread. But the locals really struggle just to keep up with the average prices.
Yeah.
And as the rates go up, then again, the buyers are forced to go down to a lower price point and the sellers need to go down with them if they want to move their property.
And it's just a matter of demographics that the higher end buyers are not coming this way yet. They're not making their way yet. We're not seeing the activity that certainly the potential's there for our higher priced properties to do more. Well,
okay, if you have a property listed right now at $750,000 or above, you're in 20 months plus supply,
and you're not getting any showings.
And you're
probably
not getting any showings.
Yeah.
That's where that market is.
Yeah.
But now if you're down there still looking in the 150 to 250 range, you got less than a 2 month supply. So that's what makes this market so crazy.
Yeah.
And you two would know better. Is that that's different than our higher end market of previous years, previous post recession surges? We've seen more activity at the higher end.
I've never seen that many.
20 months,
24, 2 year supply and $1 million.
And you're right, the contrast of the days.
Well,
potential days on market at the two ends of our market here locally.
And my still question is, since the new tax laws went into effect, second homes, et cetera, are no longer, you know, you only get $10,000 off of your property taxes, you know, for your homes and the kinds of things that went out there.
Yeah.
And so is that why people are selling them? Because there's certainly a lot on the market and not very many buyers. But then, you know, that's really limited market. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you one other question, Alice. You know, we've got lots of things come still to talk about. So many sellers say to me when you go, some Californian is going to come up here and pay my price. And my experience with it is that if people with money are not going to overpay. Tell me how you deal with that.
Yeah, you know, the buyers are very sophisticated these days anyway. They all have access to the same information online that we do.
Yeah.
And people don't want to pay more than a property is worth. And if you're coming in with cash, most of them expect some kind of a discount because they're buying with cash. So it's usually the opposite.
Yeah, well, it's there, and I don't know if that's going to go away. The cash market is just really, really messes up if you're trying to compete, you know, with multiple offers. You're competing with cash, and that's really difficult.
And last time you were here, you pointed out that price reductions were way ahead of listings, and we'd seen a surge in those. Sellers are trying to find their price point. You know, the folks that I'm working with, the place that we're looking at has come down, started in the fives, is down about 450, 449 now. And you can see over the course of about the last 4 months how they have been looking to find that price point. And
that's what you have to do in a changing market, whether it's winter or not. You have to find where the buyers are or do something else, like put in a renter, take it off the market, start over again next year, something like that.
Yeah, that's the way that
there
goes.
There are strategies,
In selling homes, and Travis Hand has joined us here. Travis is from Rogue Inspection Service. The inspections are becoming more and more important now, don't you think?
Yeah, and I think especially in the as the buyers are getting pushed down, they're very unhappy about that.
Yeah.
And so they're being forced to look at properties that are in not as great a condition and they're older. And somebody like Travis, who actually does a wide variety of inspections, not just the regular home part, is more and more important because they're pickier. They're upset at their situation and they're way more demanding. Since in their mind they're being forced into something they didn't want to get in the first place.
Don't necessarily want in the first in the first place there.
Right.
Yeah. So you come in and there you go. Right.
Right. Exactly.
And what do you find? We got a break coming up here in a minute or so. But are you finding these properties in pretty good condition? That's the thing that I don't get as we go through this is that the properties, many of them are not in very good condition.
Correct. A lot of the lower priced properties are not in that good a condition. You get quite a bit of roof damage, roofs that need to be completely replaced. You've got dry rot on the siding around the house, all your trim and joints and stuff are rotted, damage around all of that. And just find big, expensive things like that are going to need to be repaired in order to make that home good again.
And your timing is really good on that, talking about roofs and flashing and water.
Right.
Yeah, because with the rain that we've had now again, this is such a great time to go out and check your place right now. I don't care, you know, because you got water coming down off your roof. Where's it going? Are your gutters cleaned, et cetera, et cetera? And Travis is sitting there saying that we're not taking care of that. Yeah. I agree. Yeah. Roofing, we've had roofers in here. We had Mark Rudin here not very long ago talking about this same thing.
Exactly. And to Alice's point, now they're looking at homes that need some work and their price range has been compressed a little bit. They're going to want that home to be in good condition, and they're going to bargain and negotiate hard to get repairs done and have it. They're going to pay that price, but it's got to be with things in the right place.
You got to hold that thought there. You can answer that when we come back because we got a break coming up here. The Real Estate Show here on KCMX News Media 880. I love our conversation about this stuff because there's so much to it that we don't know about, and we need more information because to be smart. Anyway, we're coming right back. The Real Estate Show continues here in KCMX after this. Not to do that. Okay, you ready to go? We're gonna talk about these other things that you know that he does, and you can talk about. Okay, you're good. You good?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thank ready? You. Hey, segment
Alice is
three.
Good. Alice is great.
I know.
Nervous.
I don't know why you would be
why
nervous.
Would that be?
You've done this indeed.
You guys are scary.
Okay.
That'll give you, but don't be nervous about that.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Segment 313 goes in 3, 2, 1. And welcome back to the Real Estate Show here on KCMX News Media 880. Pete Belcaster and Joe Brett, the real estate guys, with you today here on KCMX. I hope we get tons of snow, by the way, in the mountains Mount McLaughlin the other day kind of peeked open the clouds. It was white.
All the way down into the tree lines.
Into the trees, So that is a really good sign because the worst thing we could do is, we all would know, is to sit here in May and say we don't have any water and we're going to have a bad year. And boy, Drive by Hyatt Lake. It's gone.
My friend Brandon, I work with, the MC lives there, and he says it's just a channel. But the last weekend's rains, and now there's some puddles out there beginning to form a lake again. So it's there are a few little pools out there
Don't complain about the rain, okay? You can't complain about the rain or snow until January or February when we're tired of it, and then it can go away. Anyway, we're with Alice Lehmer from John L. Scott, the real estate, here on The Real Estate Show today, and Travis Hand is right here. Travis is the owner of Rogue Inspection Services, and we're talking kind of the market today in early December and about inspections and sellers. Don't you think sellers should take more, I don't want to say interest because that's not the right word, but more control. Ownership of the sale.
Be proactive. Okay, I'm a big fan of that. In other states, the sellers provide all the due diligence up front and give it to the buyers so that it's available before they write their offers. Wow. And I'm in that camp. I like that. And the sellers don't have to fix things, but if they can do that disclosure ahead of time, it helps them because the buyers will write offers faster, even when there is disclosed damage. Mm-hmm. And since the buyers are being pushed into lower price points and there's more damage to deal with.
Which is what he just said.
Right. And some of these homes are in older neighborhoods. And one of my big soapboxes is sewer scopes. And Travis is, I think, the only person who does that with your inspection.
Okay. Now, why? And I, when you first, we had a discussion on this. And the first question was, why would I need a sewer scope? I mean, that doesn't seem like that would be anything that would help me in my sale. But then you had a story to tell, and I want you to share that about that, because I'm thinking newer homes, nothing. Older homes, I suppose, but your experience has been different, right?
We had somebody with a house built in 2012, and as part of the due diligence before the purchase completed, there was a sewer scope done, and it was
why was the sewer scope done?
Because I suggested it as a part of just understanding the entire system in the home before the purchase was completed, and there was a pipe that was broken and apparently had been broken since 2012.
Wow.
So, and then, you know, you have to report that to the city, whatever city you're in, and they are all over it. And if it's too far into the street, it, you know, can easily be a $10,000 or $12,000 repair. Wow. And the owner or whoever owns it at the time has to pay that. And that's happened to me before.
It has. Okay. Yeah. I've never happened to me,
what causes that?
You'll have to ask the expert. Right. I just know it happens, and it's a lot of zeros, and I don't want my buyer to pay for that.
And the landscaping, it's got to tear up your landscaping a little bit.
It can.
You had a hole. You had the sewage had been going into the ground for 5-6 years.
Yeah,
that's another. What a mess! That's a bad pipe. I can't even.
It was a 7 or 10 foot deep hole, and I can't remember how wide and.
What did it cost? Okay.
That one was $12,000. That was $12,000.
$12,000 to get that fixed. So did your buyer buy the property?
Yes, but they didn't have to pay for that.
But they had to clean it up, so the seller had to pay for it.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what we're talking about.
Whose watch is that on?
Travis, tell us about those. Do you do many sewer scopes? Tell us what you see when you do that and what people should know about them.
Yeah, so we do quite a few sewer scopes. It's something we're trying to get out there a little bit more.
Alice is starting to trend.
Everyone understands the importance of those. So you get a sewer line, especially the old cast iron lines. Those can corrode on the bottom, and where you can get damage either under the house in the crawl space where you've got stuff leaking in the crawl space, or further out into the yard where you've got to dig up your yard and possibly the street, and that's a big expense. So we try to make sure that the prospective buyer understands the entire situation from the roof all the way to the city connection. Make sure they understand the complete purchase that they're about to make.
That is a true top to bottom deal, isn't that?
It's kind of like going to the doctor.
Well, we were talking about that with Tom Hinton when he was here a few weeks ago, right?
And the one thing that caught my ear was sewage leaking underneath your house.
Right.
Leaking underneath my yard. I'm not happy to write that check and get it fixed, but leaking underneath my house, I can think of health hazards and really bad things associated with that.
Hazards, you can get some mold growing in your crawl space. You got air coming up in certain situations. If you've got a broken vent or something, that's a health situation.
Yeah.
Tell us some of the tell us some of the things you found.
So
what's down there?
Yeah, what's down there? I don't know.
Yeah. So a couple things we've come across is asbestos wrapped pipes. That's kind of a
asbestos wrapped
right on pipes. Your cast iron pipes. One situation where they were not going to dig up that cast iron pipe that was bad. It had some channeling on the bottom where it had corroded out, and the plumber came in, took a look at it as well, and said that that pipe was wrapped in asbestos, so they didn't want to take that out, and it was going to end up being a very expensive job, more than the $10,000 to $12,000 you normally look at for a pipe replacement.
Wow.
So that's a big concern. I haven't seen it more than once, but that is something that does happen.
How old were those pipes? That had to,
I think it was a 60s house, if I remember right.
Yeah, makes sense.
But there's a lot of 1960s houses that we sell in Southern Oregon.
Yeah. Some of our finest.
Yep. And I don't know that that's that common as far as the asbestos wrapping around that pipe, but it is just it's something I've run across.
I've never heard that. In piping older homes, okay, are you seeing more problems in older homes?
More problems in older homes, yep. Okay. Cast iron, concrete lines. I've run across a couple crushed concrete lines.
I can see crushed lines. Okay.
Yep. Cast iron, you get the channeling on the bottom where it breaks open.
So cast iron, if you have cast iron in the 1920s at your deal, that's probably not...
Right. So your normal lifespan on a cast iron line is about 50 to 80 years, depending on the condition of it, whether it's under grade, stuff like that. So that all plays a factor.
That's that channeling.
Yep.
Yeah.
It just goes, it just corrodes. That constant water flow just channels and corrodes that bottom of that pipe.
Takes a long time.
I didn't know that.
So there's a lifespan. That's the part I think we want people to remember. There's a lifespan.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, 80 years, that's pretty much max on a cast iron pipe.
And what is the responsibility of the homeowner on there? I know the city or will bring the line to the house.
No, to the street.
To the street.
Yeah, you're responsible to the street.
The homeowner's
the middle of the street.
Okay. The homeowner's responsible then for the rest of the way.
Like your $300 story about that?
What?
That was my, right by my mailboxes next to my driveway. There was that big puddle out front. It was my water.
Oh, yeah.
1029 and 1039, both water mains are right there, and there's this little PVC.
Your water main, it had worn out, right?
It was on me, but... The part I think cost $7.50 and the repairs $2.98 because it's a muddy, deep, dank. Yeah. I don't even know how you can get down there in there and fix that with all the things that takes place. But it's on the homeowner.
Okay, it is on the homeowner.
All the way out to the street.
So what is any recommendation? Can you prepare for this? I mean, there's nothing really you can do, right?
So if you're selling your house, it's an older house, even a newer house, you can have offset joints, root intrusion. Anything
roots.
Like that.
Roots.
Yeah, big.
So,
yeah.
Had that
I mean, it's not just cast iron or concrete that you see a problem with. You get the ABS or the PVC going out of the house. You can have an offset joint to where it's leaking out of that joint. You get root intrusion in there. There's several different factors that any type of pipe can have. You can get bellies in those if they're not set properly. They can sag and create a buildup, and that can cause backflow. So that's all important stuff that you'd want to know, especially if you're selling your house. You don't want that to come up later. You just want to be open and upfront about it and make sure you understand exactly what you're selling.
Yeah, because you'll lose your escrow. There's a lot of buyers that won't understand that a broken sewer pipe is not the end of the world. It can be fixed. But there are plenty of them. They just get the heebie-jeebies about the whole sewer thing, and they're out of there, and you lose your sale.
I wonder how many... How many people have bought homes who have not had sewer scopes or?
Well, most 90%
that's taken place. And I'm just thinking, 4 or 5 years down the line, they have a sewer problem. That problem. Well, that problem was probably there and probably could have been in front of it.
Yep.
But they would never associate it with, hey, that was bad. I should have checked that when I bought the house because the timing would be.
It's too late now.
Preventative,
right? It's what you
advocate. It is preventative. Yeah. And if you are buying a house, you absolutely should do one for sure. And you know the new construction? This is what caught us by surprise. Sometimes they're hooking into old sewer systems.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So there's lots of opportunities for that to happen. You also deal a lot with mold. I know you're a mold. People always talk about sometimes, you know, you want mold. We've talked about mold on the show before. You actually can do that, right? You're a mold guy. You know what's out there.
We do that as well.
Do you see a lot of mold? Tell us what you're seeing.
He's fascinated by mold.
It's a very fascinating subject.
It's a fascinating subject.
And the words in the mold are just the coolest. So that's the best part of the whole thing. So as far as the mold goes, we don't see a ton of it. And when we do, it's in homes that aren't very well taken care of.
Okay.
You get that water penetration through the exterior of the home, either from the roof or the siding into your wall cavity, and that can create an issue. Penicillium is one of the more common molds that we're finding in the area, which is a damp wood, a decaying wood.
Decaying wood.
Yep.
Okay. So water damage from wood. Remember, water damage is the number one cause of property damage. Period. So
water's great on the lakes and rivers,
but not in your house, not running off your roof. Those kinds of things. So you still, so you do see mold.
Yep.
And do you remedy it yourself, or do you?
Nope. We just test it.
You just test it.
Yep.
So someone could then. Do you ever test for mold on any properties that you sell, Alice? Or
in
how
Southern
often do you do that?
Yeah, it doesn't come up that much because we have a little more drier climate. But definitely, if something looks off color. If the client requests it, at part of the buyer's interview, we always ask if they have any health situations. Uh-huh. Do they have any breathing situations? Do they have any extreme allergies? So that we know what to look for in the house.
Yeah, I had a buyer the other day. We were in Grants Pass, and he was looking at the walls with the moisture content. I'd never.
They have handheld detectors now. Yeah.
Blew me away. And I had never seen anybody go around these walls and measuring how much moisture had come through because of drainage issues, because that was a big issue to this to this particular buyer, knowing that water was all around the house, how it came off the roof, how it went into the ground,
savvy
things
buyer.
Like that.
Yeah.
That's what I thought. And I go, well, that's pretty smart to do that as well. And anyway, we've got a break coming up here. This is an interesting topic as we get ready, because, boy, so many things can go wrong in a deal, and you want to, like, eliminate them. You know, if you can, try to cross them off the list.
Do we get to do inspection horror stories with them?
That'd be
a great segment.
We'll find out.
Can we bring pictures?
Yeah. Anyway, we got a break coming up here. We got one more segment to go. Don't forget, you can check out any of our past shows at realestateshoworegon.com. Some terrific shows there on all sorts of topics. We hope to check them out. We're coming right back. Our final segment after this.
The rain and everything.
That's what I want to ask you about. Gutters. About what should people do right now to get to for the winter?
Right. And one thing we do offer is a home maintenance inspection.
Let's talk about
that's
that. Yes, I forgot
great,
about that.
I
never heard that before. I wanted to talk to you about that. Okay. You ready to go, Joe?
Yep.
Okay. Final segment. It goes 9 minutes, so it goes really fast. Okay. So just FYI. It goes in 3, 2, 1. And welcome back to the Real Estate Show on KCMX News Media 880. Pete and Joe, the Real Estate Guys, here, and hope you're having a terrific holiday season. You know, we've been celebrating since Halloween. We go Halloween to the Super Bowl here in this in the Real
holidays.
Estate Show. That's our holiday season.
Welcome to Southern Oregon. Yeah, that's how we do it here. That whole Thanksgiving and New Year's thing was just too short.
Yeah.
We couldn't really got started, and then it was over.
We had that extended time.
Local tradition.
Yeah, it does work well. Well, Travis Hand here. From Rogue Inspection Services, entrepreneur, started his business here and is doing pretty well with that. And congratulations for you
for
that. We honor that a lot and around here. But what should people do in winter right now as rains and snows? What's your advice to folks to look around their properties and you know, I hate to use the word winterize, but get it. You know, be careful with what you've got. It's such an investment. So what's your advice there, Travis?
Right. Your home is your biggest investment. It's just it's where you live. It's your pride and joy. It's your baby. You want to take care of it. You got to make sure that you're not getting any water around your house, in your house, or damaging that, because it's a very expensive repair. So what we generally recommend is making sure that your roof's in good condition, that you don't have any foliage touching your house or anything that's going to cause prolonged moisture contact. Make sure your gutters are working properly and discharging away from the house. You don't want any water seeping back into your crawl space because your gutters are discharging right near your foundation.
Mm-hmm.
So that's all really important stuff. Making sure that all of your trim is slanted away from the house or properly flashed to make sure you're not going to get any dry rot above your window trim, door trim, anything like that.
Because you do see dry rot around right. here, right? I mean, that's something that we do see a lot of. Okay.
Right. If you've got siding in contact with the grade, you'll see rot kind of starting from the bottom and going up that and just kind of damaging that bottom layer of siding. So you want to make sure you've got good clearance between the ground and your siding. So that's all stuff that we look at and make sure is in good condition. One thing that we do is home maintenance inspections. So if it's something that you're not able to do on your own or want a professional opinion on, we can come out and just spend about an hour around your property and make sure that the proper things are taken care of.
That's really cool.
You mean someone who really knows as opposed to my inspection of my property? Yeah, right. That really helps to have that trained eye.
It's talked about water damage. The biggest thing I see, and I don't know if Alan sees this, but from gutters that just roll down onto the sidings of the house. Yeah. These are things that can be really remedied, but you got to go up and look at it around. But water damage, even coming off of your spouts down into the ground, if they come straight down into unless you have a drain there, they're gonna go into your house and then up in the moisture that we were just talking about last time.
Yeah, and it'll compromise your foundation eventually. Yeah. And it needs to be directed away from it. If you've ever crunched your downspout with your car, then you need to fix that. It's not like oops, and then you can just forget it.
Yeah, well, I think that's the trick. And you said earlier that the roofs that you see and you inspect, there's a lot of damage on roofs around this valley, isn't there?
There is. There's quite a bit. Even on some of the newer roofs, you see the sun damage, the UV damage, and the fiberglass showing through.
What about moss?
Moss is a big deal.
Everywhere,
on the north
side.
North side. You really got to be careful with that.
Yep. You want to keep an eye on that. Make sure you get it treated. Never power wash your roof. Never sweep your roof. Get it done professionally. There is moss cleaner, stuff like that. You can buy at a department store, but make sure you follow those directions on that. And don't ever power wash your roof because it will ruin it.
I've got an 8-year-old roof, and when I did my gutters last week, noticed on my north side of my roof. It's just starting, so
moss. Moss.
Just little tiny little.
Let's bring a buyer to your house, and the roof is full of moss.
Oh,
what's going to happen?
Yeah.
Oh, they get so worried, especially if they're from out of the area. If they're from California or Washington, they really, really get scared.
Yeah. Get rid of the moss before you put it on the market because they're going to walk away from it.
But do it gently so you don't ruin your roof.
You don't want to ruin the roof. The other part of roofing that I see as a problem is that right at the end, the flashing, if there's no flashing, that starts to rot away. It's so visible when you're taking clients around and buyers are looking. And I guess the bottom line is, don't you think if you want the price you're getting for your house, it's got to be pretty darn moving ready.
Yep.
Don't you think?
Yeah.
Everything's got to be working. Now, Travis has something that I've not heard before. You have a guarantee that you're doing on your inspections, right?
Right. So that's correct.
I've not heard that. What is that?
It's fabulous.
That is. Yes, this is interesting.
So our inspections are covered under a 90-day warranty, $0 deductible to the buyer. And if it is a seller's inspection, that's an automatic 120-day warranty, and that covers the same period and same time. So that covers everything that's in good working condition at the time of the inspection. And if anything's not working that was working when we did the inspection, that's covered by our
sponsor. So you're saying if my HVAC goes out, if you've looked at it and you confirm it's working
right.
Proper condition, in 90 days, if it goes out, that it's covered on this type of thing.
Yep, that's correct. You would contact the warranty company that we work with, and they will take care of that.
Okay.
And I think that includes a sewer scope too, doesn't it?
Yep.
Yeah. So that sewer scope, actually, if you don't know what that is, that's a video. They have a camera, and they give you a link with the actual footage, so you can see yourself. It's a little on the disgusting side sometimes, but you actually have a document. And I think for insurance purposes and things like that in the future, plus the guarantee, it just can't be beat.
Well, you try to do the pre-inspection, don't you? I mean, you really, it's for your sellers to get this stuff done. So you
I
know
do,
what
and really, you know, what happens is that the buyers like it so much, they'll pay more for the house.
Yeah.
Even if the repairs were not done, a lot of times they will write the offer sooner and higher.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's good advice as we sit here in the end. We're almost out of time. Rest of the month. Next week, you won't be here next week, but next week the MLS stats will be out, so we'll get an update on kind of what September, October, November look like. I can't wait to see all the all those numbers. We have no life except looking at these, at these statistics. Right, but it'll be interesting. What's on the horizon? You just think you're worried about interest rates more than anything else, if I hear you right.
Well, I am, because I just have so many millennials that are trying so hard to get their first house. And right now we're trying to load them up with the friends and family plan so they can get some help so they can weather these changes and get a house sooner than later. Mm-hmm. But it's all going to be fine. I mean, people buy and sell houses in all kinds of markets. It's just a different market. We just have to adjust.
It's normalizing is how we say.
It's soggy. Yeah.
I've had a license for 10 years. I ain't seen nothing normal about our market in any of that time.
Wow, we've started quite a ride. We started way down here. We all started together. Yeah. The three of us. We were way down here in the market, and look what it's done though.
Yeah.
It's done nothing but go up maybe even now. That's just kind of not going down. It's kind of normalizing.
I don't know if we would have had a normal market all that time gone down to the bottom and come back past where we would have been on a...
I just hope we learned our lessons from the last time.
It's amazing just to watch it transpire.
That. That's the other side. Yeah. But we still have a lot of demand because people want to come here and live. And prices are...
It is such a great time to buy. Oh, my gosh. We're in a dip. They always say buy on the dip. If you're an investor... Get out there and grab a couple more addresses.
Yeah, absolutely.
Get a good inspection.
And Travis, wish you well. Thank you for coming and sharing with us. And you can get a hold of Travis at rogueinspections.com, or you can email him at travis@rogueinspections.com. So wish you well. Actually, I'd have you back, you know, as we go along here, because I think you're going to see more and more of this, especially these older homes, older neighborhoods.
And inspections are evolving. More tools and more ways to protect buyers and sellers.
It's easier to do.
Yeah.
And you get more information of your house. Because the bottom line, if you're selling, you want the most money you can for your property. The best way to do that is to be prepared and have know exactly what your property is like. Yeah. So your price is right and people will buy it, right?
Yep.
All right. Well, that's going to do it for the Real Estate Show here for December. The 1st is our date. For Pete Belcaster and Joe Brett, Alice Lehman, Travis Hand, thanks for being with us. Have a great week. God bless you all. We'll talk to you next Saturday right back here on KCMX.